So we'll start the panel with the introductions from the panelists.
I'm Lakshmi Sharma. I'm head of product management, cloud networking, and networking services at Google. This is my third week there. So I'll talk about what I've done before. So I started my career as an engineer, network engineer. When I say network, you know, writing to network processors. Stayed with a small company for a couple of years, and then kept doing a lot of, like, you know, take IPsec draft, pick up like L2TP v3 or L2TP draft, do a lot of programming, and in due course, like, you know, found mentors, like, not that I was looking for mentors, but found people, like, you know, who kept finding my strengths and then kept putting me into places like where I could best deliver. And to be honest, if it wasn't for the right set of people in my early stage of kind of early life and working life, I don't think I would have been, I would have a vision of where I could be, because I come from a very different background where, you know, I'm the first girl ever to go to a college from my family, although I come from a very good business family. So that was very important to me, and they kept motivating me. And then I, you know, every time I picked up a role, I picked up the leader, even if it required me to take, you know, take a hit with my title or composition. So because I learned so much by having a good leader or mentor, and then I continue to do the same thing. When I see people like who have potential, I just look for them. And you know, I love technology, and then those qualities that I find in my leaders, I try to kind of just, you know, portray in myself. Small company, went to Cisco, joined a team which has just been acquired, and then they were looking at what to do. So it became ASR1K, CSR1KV, and then joined Juniper, started internal SDN team, led the engineering team for packet core. So kept kind of, you know, not intentionally, but it's just because I followed certain leaders and certain practices. I kept working with people, and then for past 6 years, it has been a lot of SDN and a lot of cloud. I ran a startup called Rift.io, where we did NFV cloud platform for Cisco. You know, that's where I met Robert. And well, Cisco was going through this transition from a box company to a hardware agnostic, you know, software as a service or networking as a service. So that's where I was at Cisco. I was running engineering team for network function virtualization group. Started cloud networking solutions with some really smart leaders. Did startup, then I went to Brocade, led their software-defined networking product management team. I've done so much, and I thought like NFV, VNF, all these things were like kind of growing so much, like a lot of open sourcing. Open sourcing kind of drove that, ODL, OPNFE. Then OpenStack, a lot of things that Cisco did, and I was part of it, and then Robert was also part of some. So we that power of, like, you know, developer, and then that has really, you know, I would say, upped the game in networking. A lot of people, like, you know, 5-6 years ago, to be honest, like, oh, you know, Cisco, Juniper, Ericsson, Brocade, these are all kind of old companies. They're doing old things, and networking is no more cool. Thanks to Nicira, thanks to ONS, thanks to OPNFE, and thanks to software. And thanks to companies like Intel and AMD, who are doing innovation in CPUs and NICs, and then while people kept thinking that, hey, you know, networking could never be cool. So I just kind of stayed, you know, at that side. And after doing a lot of that, I was like, hey, I want to see how IT is transforming, because every time you talk about cloud, you just talk about ITs. So that's where I took the job at Target. It was, you know, Vice President for Infrastructure Cloud Compute, migrating services, you know, how to make decisions about IoT, do you introduce robot or not introduce that. That was fantastic, like, but to be honest, I just followed kind of, you know, good leadership and where transformation was happening. I didn't worry, you know, as I said, you know, where would I land, but my vision has always been to work with great leaders, follow the right technology, and then you'll just end up being there. And then I'm really, really, you know, I believe in the power of the software development networking. To be honest, I feel like the biggest kind of, you know, kick that happened to my career was when SDN started, like, you know, 6-7 years ago, when the word SDN was coined. That really has enabled clouds and enabled the ecosystem of a lot of companies which are coming. Every single company that you see, ML, AI, all of that, you know, it's really APIs, and it's really software, and it's really software-driven intelligence, software-defined networking, all of that. So best place to be is, and then, you know, Intel has been, not just because she's sitting here, but I do believe I worked a lot with Intel in almost all my companies. So yeah, work together, build the ecosystem. I think every single big company or small company has become one company now because of the developer eco-friendly system.
I'm Robert Starmer, I'm founder of Kunos Technologies. We're a technology consultancy, so we help people migrate their services in the cloud. I actually was a long time Cisco. That was sort of my big growth in the industry in general, and it's kind of weird to think that a cloud resource comes out of a company like Cisco. But I mean, Lakshmi and I think are both proof that that can happen. But the reality is that even when I started at Cisco, which was almost 20 years ago now, I started focusing on the applications. I worked in the load balancing group, I worked in the caching group. These are all technologies that people don't necessarily think of as networking technologies, and yet at the time, it was a networking company that was working on and looking at these particular technologies to help accelerate applications. But it's always been this interaction between applications and their use of the network. And you know, if we fast forward to today, the areas that are really interesting to me are not necessarily the classic NFV or SDN functions, but it's tools like Istio, service mesh type capabilities. These are, again, proxies, load balancers, scale components, and you know, where they're being placed and run on computers. But in reality, they are network functions. They are things that are accelerating our environment because of the network. And again, to me, that's where these two pieces really start to fit and to mesh. You know, my career path that drove me to this particular position was always trying to help people find how these new technologies enabled their business, right? Because I was always sort of working on some of these more bleeding edge components, even with many years at just one big company. And finally, it was like, the company's too big. I can't help at a mega scale company helping other mega scale companies do this. We have to find the smaller companies that are able to be more agile in their thought process, in their development process. And that's what's led me to doing what I do today, helping people make these transitions and migrations.
So did you know that Istio team is something which is also part of my work now?
Oh, no.
Yeah, see, that's the power of, like, you know, application and an open source and developer framework, you know?
Yeah.
We are connected again.
Yeah, exactly.
So I mentor a couple of people. I was just talking to one of them who's not part of my company, before this session. So yeah, I think one of the things that if you have focus, you know, just stay focused on the dream that you want to achieve. This could be philosophical, but I grew up in a culture where they just talk about, you know, if you're focused on the eye of a fish, then you just stay focused. And there will be people who will come in your way, but then you have to collect your strengths and the, you know, the people who are there to support you. Because even if you're one person, and that person, you can just work with that person and then build that set of people who are like you, right? So then build that ecosystem of people who will support each other, right? Keep doing it. And then you will end up helping, building that such a huge network of people who will support each other that you are not, you know, you would worry about, yeah, there would be things. But so I'll give very, you know, one of the SVPs at Cisco is still at Cisco. So in my second time, we were doing the cloud work, and then I was given this huge charter, like, you know, okay, build this thing which is called Virtual Managed Services Cloud VPN, and we need people from all across Cisco, like, wow. And then I had no people. And then first you have to get the product, get it going to the customer. So I go to this, you know, to this person, and then he was my SVP even before, first time at Cisco. So I asked him, I said, like, you know, I'm worried because there's so much money and I'm given so much budget, but I'm not sure, like, you know, what if people will come in my way? Will I be successful? Because building cloud for cloud-based services for Cisco is huge, and Cisco is a hardware company, and I have to do something which is software agnostic. And then these are the people who were my managers and, you know, mentors at some point. So one thing which he said, that the companies which are successful, the reason that they're successful is that when the company decides to move in a direction like Cisco, then everybody just automatically comes along. You know, that's the reason they're successful. So he said, you know, nobody will come in your way when you're doing an execution. And then if you're just focused on execution, I promise, Lakshmi, nobody will come in your way. And it actually happened. Until we get to the end, things happen afterwards. Nobody really came. So I think that's the power of execution. You know, just genuinely, like, when you're given a charter, believe in your charter, make your team believe into that charter, and you just keep moving. And I believe that there would, people would not come in your way until you get to the finish line.
Yeah, so like you see, my name is Sanjeev Dang, Investment Director, Intel Capital. For those, how many people are familiar with Intel Capital? Okay, only a few. So I'm happy to give a quick primer on Intel Capital. So we are the venture capital arm of Intel, as the name indicates. We invest roughly $400 to $500 million every year in startups, primarily, I would say, in the US, but we are pretty global investors in general. We invest in Europe, we invest in Asia, Latin America, Japan, everywhere. We really look for a mix of strategic returns as well as financial returns. Financial returns are very similar to if you have a startup, you pitch to any investor, any VC, they will look for how you grow, how does the company grow financially, what markets do you are you selling into, and how does that grow? So those metrics are very similar for us as well. But in addition to that, we look for strategic returns. So we work together with Intel business units. Sujata is a close partner and others. So we look for companies that are able to bring strategic value to Intel as well, whether it is to help develop the ecosystem around Intel products, whether it is to plug in a gap in Intel's roadmap, or it is to accelerate what Intel is doing internally. So we look for a variety of things. I would say 80% of the companies we invest into are software companies. I think back in the day, Intel Capital was kicked off 26 plus years ago. And back in the day, Andy Grove realized that, hey, we can't be a successful hardware company if we only do hardware. And so he said, well, he started realizing the importance of software. And that's when he said, well, we have to start forming alliances with developers like all of you and start investing in the external ecosystem as well. So that's why we exist as a firm. And like I mentioned, we invest around $400 to $500 million every year. That makes us probably among the top two or top three venture capitalist firms in the world. Because if you take a venture capital firm, they have a fund, even if the big ones have $2 billion fund, that's over 7 to 10 years. So, for those of you who are familiar with the startup / venture capital world, most startups struggle to find a lead investor. Lead investor is the one, if you have a startup, you go to him or her and you say, hey, I want you to lead, and they will do most of the diligence. They will put the term sheet, they will set your pricing, valuation, and everything. Lot of the VC firms do not lead by design. They want somebody else to lead and they will follow or participate in your round. We actually do the opposite. We lead most of the rounds we invest into. We lead, I would say, 70% of the deals we do. 30% of the times we are participating. Examples of companies, just to give you a more perspective on the type of companies we invest into. There's a company I did called Body Labs out of New York. It finally got acquired by Amazon 3 months ago. This was a company that I invested into at Series A stage. We led their Series A round 2 years ago. And the company is a computer vision engine for 3D body modeling. Initially, it started with relying on 3D camera. This is a software-only company, but it relied on having a 3D camera. But then over time, the technology evolved so much that they didn't even need the 3D camera, so they could do it with a regular 2D camera like in your smartphone. And you guys are all familiar with Amazon Echo, but now Amazon is putting camera in Amazon Echo called Echo Look. So imagine Echo with a camera in your room. I understand it's creepy to some people, but that's what Amazon is trying to do. They're always pushing the boundary, right? But so anyways, they built the hardware, and then they needed a software engine. So this company is going to become that computer vision engine and scale to every look device in the next 1 or 2 years. Another company we invested in, TrueFit, which helps solve fitting problem, purely data-based company. It doesn't ask you to do measurements or scan yourself. It just asks you a simple question, which shirt from your closet fits you the best? And the way they suggest, they know, okay, based on your answer, the shirt you're looking at on Macy's.com will not fit you. is a better fit. And the way they know it is because they have gone to the brands and mapped out all SKUs, all the apparel and shoes SKUs out there, data of all of that, and then they can tell, all right, if this shirt fits you, the one you're looking at will not fit you because I have the data of both the shirts. So it's a very data intensive problem, and it's probably one of the very few companies that have solved this problem for online shopping. I hope this gives you a perspective of the type of companies we invest into, and I'm happy to chat more if needed.
Thank you, Sanjeev, for that introduction.
Can I just market to Intel Capital's marketing? So I ran a startup called Rift.io, which was funded by Intel Capital, so I was in Burlington for 11 months, and then there were, you know, lot of customers that we got. Most of the leads that we got were because of Intel Development Forum and all. So we will go to all sort of places. We could start our open source group called Open Source Mano with the support and the help that we got from the Intel Capital and the associated kind of connections we got. So I
have to hear. Thank you. Thanks, Manish.
My daughter asked me, like, you know, what do you do? So I used to work at Cisco at the time, and I said, like, you know, you won't understand it. I write, like, you know, software for the router and switches, you know, that thing which sits in our house, which helps you, like, you know, view videos through your phone. It's boring. I was like, what? No. It helps me see the YouTube videos. How can you say it's boring?
But jokes apart, and to that point, since Intel is a very pervasive organization, it has data center group, so like networking, compute, storage. Similarly, it has client-facing group, and it has new technologies, new areas like IoT, etc. coming up. And hence, Intel Capital actually invests into a variety of areas. So the examples I mentioned are some of the deals that I did. But overall, from an Intel Capital perspective, we invested in networking. Software-defined networking has been a key focus area. Big data, we invested in Cloudera. I was lucky to be part of that deal. We invested in Cloudera. This is in the Hadoop space. So we invest at both infrastructure level as well as at the application level. Rift.io is a very good example, actually, of a company at an infrastructure level.
So I just wanted, like, you know, your comments on the business of open source, or, like, you know, how does it make business sense?
No, I think that's actually very easy. Many companies, at least that I work with, have real trouble finding a technology, understanding how the technology is going to help them improve their business, and then sort of being willing to pay for that up front. Open source shifts that equation, because often the initial investigations, even the initial test deployments, can all be done in a very straightforward fashion. Often there's a developer or an infrastructure manager that has said, hey, this is such an important piece of technology, I can just start to implement it right off the bat. I don't have to get any approvals to start leveraging these new capabilities. And we see that, I think, to a dramatic extent in the sort of the software as a service space now, where people are able to build tools that they wouldn't have even had a chance to start to pull together, because the costs of software used to be so detrimental to that acceleration. At the same time, open source does not answer all questions. When you start talking to companies that are of a certain scale, at least, one of the first questions that comes up is, as you're talking about open projects as a way of enabling a particular capability, is how do I support this? How do I, with my team of developers that are trying to build my technology, not that particular capability, how do I support this thing? So how do I get somebody else to help me with that? So suddenly you need that enterprise support capability on top of what was otherwise an open, very flexible platform, right? And we saw that in the OpenStack community, where people would build OpenStack, but if they didn't have a way of then hiring a company to help them support it, they had to build a much larger team to try to support that piece of open source technology, and usually that failed. Right, it's the companies that were able to find that right support model plus open technology that I think really found success.
So basically, you're talking about like Linux, Red Hat kind of combination.
Yeah, exactly.
That's a good analogy.
Right.
I'll take an example from the from three places, like, you know, Google being a cloud provider, or Target, which is an application developer, and then the previous example, offering cloud platforms and infrastructure. So one thing which has happened, right? So all the networking and networking services innovation that we talked about, like application load balancers, DNSs, NDPIs, and AVCs and all, I mean, that all that took like almost like what, 30, 50 years to be built and go back to internet innovation. Like think about 40, 50 years. And then 6-7 years ago, then you suddenly see like, and 2012, NFV paper comes in, then SDN gets defined, then SD-WAN. How would you scale to that, right? You cannot scale to that without the power of open source. You need to bring a huge community, set of people who are all over the world, like who are just willing to code. And then there is so much talent out there which was not there, like, you know, many years ago. So open sourcing to me has enabled that set of people who come from very diverse backgrounds and working, all of them working on different problems at the same time around the same code base. So then it allows a company like, let's say, Target, and you know, or say a company like, you know, so service providers who were seen as like, hey, they're the slowest people, Comcast and AT&T, but look at how much innovation they have done. You know, software defined, yeah, people kind of bash OpenStack, but a lot of clouds are running on OpenStack, VNFs are running on OpenStack. So if you're into that business, like you do want the power of thousands of people, hundreds of thousands of people, working towards the code and bringing new feature set. And then going back to his point that then you will take that code and make it performant for your infrastructure. If you're a data center, then you will just use your, you know, enterprise application, evolve that. If you're a service provider, you will pick up a VNF or NFV, and then you will just evolve on the performance and the scalability around it. But if it was not for those hundreds of thousands of people who work in those open source communities, many of them, whether it is Golang, like, you know, Istio, Kubernetes, OpenStack, the kind of value and the knowledge that has come in because of the open sourcing, I think it's tremendous. And that's the reason we are able to, so many companies have been able to make so much progress. And just taking the recent example of TensorFlow, look at the number of companies which are doing AIs and all that work based on these deep minds and the machine learning and AI APIs that exist, because it's right there for you to build your company upon, right? So that's what I believe. Like it's really enabled all of us to go and explore innovation at various levels in almost every vertical and horizontal you can imagine.
Yeah, thank you. So you're basically talking about like companies working as a community and contributing towards a common goal and then taking the results and maybe customizing to their own needs.
I totally agree with those comments, and I think Intel as a company has thrived very well with adoption of open source, and Intel obviously helps drive some of it as well. From an Intel Capital perspective, we invest in open source companies all the times. We do look for some critical mass of developer adoption before we start getting into it. I talked about Cloudera, which is a Hadoop company that's Hadoop is all open source, and Cloudera has its own distribution of Hadoop, but it's a fork from open source version of Hadoop. And similarly, we invested in Mirantis, if you guys are familiar with that. That's an OpenStack based company, again, another open source company. So we invest in open source companies all the times. And the thing we look for really is how does the contribution of this company and the developer ecosystem to their distribution help give them differentiation over time, because a lot of the open source companies they start with giving out the core for free and then they start charging for features around it. For example, security or manageability features, enterprise grade features, and that's when the business model starts to evolve. Otherwise, it becomes a services company, purely a services company, which is hard to scale or hard to monetize and get a good valuation on. So those are some of the things that we look for when we invest in open source companies.
So
services
based on open source, right?
Well, I think the comment you made about community is interesting, right? That without a community, it's you don't really have an open source project. You have something that's open source code, right? But once you have a community, you actually have a project. You have people that are able to contribute or at least start to consume and then, you know, adjust the technology to fit real needs. And that then drives that open technology into something that, as you said, you might find specific extensions that are enterprise extensions, and it becomes an open source product company. Or maybe you don't find that and you find that it really is more of a services organization that needs to be built.
Yeah,
I've seen and worked with both of those sorts of organizations.
One of the questions that I have is that you guys have been in the SDN world for quite some time. What's your take on the real deployment? And what are the challenges if some, say for example, a startup is here, which is doing SDN. One of the challenges that I have, at least I know of, is that when you go and talk to IT, many of them may not really know much about it or they don't care. What's your take from the inside point of view in terms of what is it that you guys have seen?
Well, I can say I've seen two views. One is SDN as the end purpose. If you're in a networking company, and I worked, like I said, in a couple of networking companies for a while, often the goal was to sell somebody on SDN as the answer. And that's, I find, kind of backwards, because the real issue is what's the application, what does the application need? If you're a service provider, having software-definable and software-manageable networks, whether they be classic, hardware-based networks that have software extensions that make it easier to manage, or actually build proper overlay-modeled SDN networks, the need is the flexibility, the fungibility, the self-service capabilities and extensions that SDN provides. In enterprises, it's the same thing. Deploying an SDN within an enterprise may not make sense for its own right, just to say, well, now I have SDN. I've deployed one and it's wonderful. My network admins like it because it's more flexible, but that didn't necessarily provide any business value. So if there's a business driver, service providers have sort of obvious business need for it. Enterprises, depending on what they're trying to do, may not have as much of a need. I look at OpenStack as an example of a consumer of SDN. So OpenStack was the application that wanted to leverage SDN because it allowed for API-driven network capabilities. Right? What was the actual driver was OpenStack making this easy, and yet we looked at the very complex, highly capable SDN systems that people were trying to integrate in, and most of them never got used. They got used in service provider environments, again, where it really made sense to have that kind of flexibility and some of the capabilities that those systems provided. But when you actually started looking at smaller enterprises, the complexity of the high-end SDN services didn't meet the business need, right? The simple SDN that was embedded in OpenStack, the simplest functions of Neutron as a software-defined network engine, were adequate. Right. And it was really interesting to see, some people really struggle with the SDN aspect of an environment. Beneficial as it could be, it didn't provide business value for that particular use case. So to me, that was the big question. What's the business value that SDN will derive? If there is business value that we can show, then absolutely it makes sense to go through the learning curve of using SDN and the enablement of allowing that software-defined network to really provide some value.
I'll add to that, and I completely agree, right? So SDN, on IT side, SDN is what does it mean? Okay, software-defined networking. But what do I really use it for? Segmentation and, isolation. And, that I can achieve with VLAN. I write, some Java code, Python code, I already achieve it. And I put it on top of VMware, I put it on top of OpenStack. So fully agree, right? So a lot of ITs believe that they're already doing it because there were some players who were offering that kind of segmentation, in their data centers, and then their newer applications don't really fit the mantra of that cross-vendor, cross-server kind of SDN philosophy. So the goal is is your application, but some larger enterprises where they do own their WAN, And in certain cases, they want to bring in the managed services from third parties back to their, to the data centers. That's happening a lot too, because they don't want to be paying money to the managed network providers, not service providers. So in those cases, SDN makes a lot of sense to them. But for smaller companies with 2-3 data centers, if they've already deployed data center design, or if they have one of those, names who had been offering them network segmentation, absolutely agree with you. They do not understand, or they do not want to, they do not like the newer definition, because they all believe that VLAN and VX clients have been serving that purpose for them.
So when you talk about business proposition of SDN, you work for Google, right? Google has
is an excellent example of someone who's using it in their own network, right, on their own.
So that goes big to the big size IT, right? So like any big size IT, they would, there are a lot of examples, like service provider ITs, right? AT&T's data center, or Deutsche Telekom's data center, Telefonica's cloud and data center, all of their ITs, they do use Comcast IT, right? All of these big vendors with their big IT infrastructure, it absolutely makes sense for them to do it. You know, you don't want to be putting in like big, like, you know, three-tier architecture or like closed fabric, because it's just too expensive. And then it's not as agile as you want it to be. The whole idea of SDN was that you can deliver services faster, right? So the traditional models don't allow you to do that. So that's why it's worth investing into that. If you have hundreds of thousands of applications and users, but you have relatively less number of applications, you're talking about 100, maybe 1,000 or 2,000. I don't think it will make a lot of sense to introduce SDN solutions, like the SDN solutions that we know of.
Yeah, I think the interesting sort of tipping point for me is whether or not your development, your internal application consumption models, whether it's internal apps or as Lakshmi was saying, and I might be looking at trying to use more software as a service type resources. Do I have to tie into those services to provide my security channel through VPN? Do I need to automate that? If I'm tying into a third party system, maybe it's a hybrid cloud platform or infrastructure services that I need to automatically connect to, and I actually want dynamic capabilities. Why am I using a hybrid cloud if I don't want something dynamic out of it, right? I want to be able to connect to wherever those services and resources exist. Suddenly my network isn't just a simple segmented service that, oh, VXLAN takes care of that or VLAN takes care of that. I need to establish that end-to-end connection dynamically. Now the software definition of that network becomes valuable, so SDN as a tool enables me to change how I'm doing my business. But again, it's being driven by the applications that I want to deploy or how I want to go and change how I'm deploying my applications. Those are the business needs that make SDN a really valuable technology. Right? I think for the first couple of years, the buzz was just SDN is the new thing. I have to have that. I don't even know what it is. I don't even understand the definition. I have to have that in my network for whatever reason. But I think we're now getting more, effectively, we're seeing more coherence in the business needs, things like dynamic applications, hybrid use cases for cloud resources, be they SaaS applications or infrastructure services in a hybrid model, where you need that VPN session, you need that segment, whatever that segment technology is, you need that segment to be dynamically created and deleted when you're done with that service.
So you're talking about like network segmentation, network slicing.
Network policy, segmentation, services. You know, maybe you're actually using, Istio is kind of an interesting one. So this whole concept of a service mesh. It's effectively a centralized proxy in some ways of thinking about it, or a distributed centralized proxy, at least a hard way of thinking of it. But those technologies are things that could potentially span sites, but that means that you still have to be able to create that connection. What is that secure connection, that path that you would let your traffic, your business go over? How do you enable that? Well, again, software automation is what we think of to do that, and what does the network then enable? Well, I have to have a software-enabled network to be able to make use of some of these technologies.
I think you guys captured most of it. I was thinking, I think the only thing I would add is if you want to start looking at, I don't want to say successful examples really, but there have been acquisitions that Cisco has made recently in the SDN space. We knew some of those companies pretty well, pretty intimately actually. So I won't, despite the big dollar numbers, 600 million and or even higher for some of those acquisitions, I won't say those companies were actually at revenue scale level. So to your point, yeah, it's not there, but I think the promise is there. And I don't know if it's public or not, but one of those companies, one of the startups that was acquired, they had gotten a big retailer to switch from Cisco to them. That's why Cisco went after acquiring it. I mean, like, wait a minute, what's happening here? So then that was the tipping point for that startup and hence for Cisco to take a serious look at that company. So I think you'll see more of those trends happening. The adoption is still slow because of the points that Lakshmi and Rob mentioned. I think it will happen over time. It's in the right direction.
So I think that's a great point, and what you also mentioned. So when I was thinking SDN, I was saying that you going to an IT and saying that using word SDN. So that's not how you start those conversations. It will not play. So the way you should be that, you know, how you will help them migrate your applications and how would you help them reduce their cost. So companies like, you know, so when you hear word like software-defined security, software-defined WAN, the companies, you build a company and then you go and tell them that this is how I will take away your services cost. This is how I will take away the number of contractors that you have working on managing this particular device. So if you start your conversation that way, then you can build a lot of these successful ideas and do it that way. So when I was mentioning SDN, I actually meant that using word SDN versus have that conversation about how do you bring the value to them, and then you could be a big disruptor. Call it software, and I kind of pick up on your last line. So software-defined automation. They understand what IT understand automation big time, because a lot of data centers and DevOps and CI/CD, you get the best developers from that world, whether it is Spinnaker working with GCP, whether it is Kubernetes deployed in almost many ITs, and it's just awesome. The kind of application developers that you get in ITs is phenomenal. So have a conversation with them and how you help them build better application and reduce their cost. And then put software automation in front, that will definitely play.
Yeah, and you can still put network in there too. What's our take on white boxes or next gen SDN? Yeah, well, so I think it sort of comes back to the same thing. If there's a value prop from a business perspective, I think new technology can always help, right? Next generation white, well, I guess you're really talking about what about white boxes instead of brand name hardware? You know, I think the comparison I would make is it looks more like the open source model, right? What's the software that's running on that box? Because in reality, I mean, even at Cisco, we always joke, yeah, we're a hardware vendor, but it's all about the software, right? The software is really what makes the difference between something that runs well and something that runs poorly, something that's easy to manage or hard to manage, right? And so from a white box perspective, I think you see that. It's absolutely possible to build a network in a data center using purely white box technology with the absolute simplest of software. You don't even have to get custom software on it. You can absolutely make the connectivity work. But as soon as you start doing that, if you do need to deal with segmentation, if you do need to deal with some of the services that networks can do best, you end up starting to look at software-defined network technology to layer on top of that now simplified local network, right? And I think that's the thing, the trend that we will continue to see. The business value of SDN is driven by specific applications, application requirements, interactions and integrations with third parties. We haven't even talked about IoT or edge computing, some of these sorts of technologies where suddenly, again, it's the dynamic nature of these next generation services that we're seeing people just now be able to start to develop that are driving a need for more dynamic network resource, network access, network control. And that's what's driving changes in how SDN even functions in certain cases, right? But yeah, white box or not white box, that really depends on your support model.
There is a lot of talk going on around SP4 and white box, next generation of open source.
Well, but even OpenFlow as a technology is a very powerful technology if you have a need for it, right? And new capabilities are driving a need for it. It's easier to deal with dynamically changing environments by describing flows than it is by trying to describe access lists at the edge of the network. Right? And so if you have advanced models of OpenFlow, if you know OpenNFV and some of the engines that are driving the management of those flows are getting better because the use cases are being better understood, right? The original OpenFlow code was designed around some examples that a set of college students dreamed up. Right? That doesn't really map to business value. But over time it does map to business value because we start to understand how to use these technologies and how to use the control planes that we're being given access to. Right. So there are big shifts that happen there.
Yeah, so one of the critiques of OpenFlow that I've heard is that it's too much, it's very hard to implement in software. It depends too much on hardware, the way it is defined right now.
Right. Well, I mean, the initial open flow required a particular hardware forwarding engine, right? So that was the original model. And then somebody rewrote it in software, and it works. It does work, but it's not the most performant thing in the world.
I think the thing with software defined is that it gives you a lot of flexibility, but then it puts a lot of complexity in operational model, right? So the balance would be that, you know, how much flexibility do you need and how much agility do you need? So if that's your primary driver, then the protocols, I call them southbound, right? P4 or OpenFlow or even BGP or any other protocol, they are just a way to get to that flexibility, and then you can build your own versions too. So white box, if you call white box, like I've seen, like, you know, there could be white boxes. The reason that, you know, just going back to what Robert said, that is the white boxes are flourishing because the power has gone to processors and NICs, right? And then you put some kind of specialized engine to make it look like a supercomputer. I truly believe all the machine learning and the super, like literally the supercomputers and the autonomous cars, the things we talk about, and then, you know, the use cases we just heard in the, you know, Amazon buying those companies, they wouldn't have been possible without the power of white boxes. I mean, because the amount of innovation that goes in, you really need to pick up pieces which are there and then build your power of your innovation, your startup, your idea into it to get the things off the ground. So I do believe that white box is not like a router kind of white boxes. To me, it could be a chip, it could be a microchip, it could be a Bluetooth. White boxes in that sense, you know, that is really important. And you see the consolidation happening in the industry. Like, look at all the consolidation on the chip side, right? Marvel and others, right? Broadcom, and then now you hear all these news about how all the companies' consolidations is happening. That kind of says that, you know, white boxes slash the white label, like, let's say instead of white box, white label model is really taking, but we should, you know, we should also hear from Sanjeev and then how he's seeing it.
Yeah, I think the way we see it is, and you can look at several companies in the SDN space that are following this approach. They are trying to white label their hardware. It is a trend. And because a lot of what is in the hardware is getting commoditized, despite what Intel wants to sell, you know, in the market, still, Intel is, despite the commoditization, Intel is able to survive well because of the scale we have and the market position we have. But if you look beyond, I think that's a trend that we have seen dramatically in the last 3-4 years, and you're only going to see that increase over time. And if you are able to create the values, move the value stack up into the software layer, whether it is at an application level or at the middleware level, I think you will gain more value from that. Going back to Viptela example, they had a Viptela brand box where anybody could make that box. There was nothing in that box that was really that unique for them. You can start looking at other companies. Nutanix doesn't do a white label approach, but it's near that approach almost, right? So I think you'll see an increase of that trend going forward.
So you mentioned IoT and, like, you know, the next generations. Intel is also, like, you know, big push on 5G and IoT. So what's your take on, like, you know, how, like, you know, where we are in that space and how network transformation is playing a role in that?
On the enterprise / industrial side, from a use case perspective, you can, if you start putting sensors in a factory, and if you can get data real time and hence predict when a particular machine is going to go down, that could be millions of dollars of savings for that company. So there's a big business ROI there. So I think you're going to see a lot of IoT innovation happen towards the enterprise plus industrial segment. And SDN will play a critical role there. And to Rob's earlier point, I think IoT will have a bimodal distribution where edge will get smarter over time, not just the cloud. You can look at an autonomous vehicle, for example. If one car sees an accident or bump on the road, you want that data to pretty quickly go. You want that car to quickly analyze that data versus sending the image to the cloud and waiting for that network. Networks are choked already. We start adding billions of more IoT devices and hope the video and the imagery will go to the cloud and the cloud will run the model and give me a real-time answer. It's not going to happen. So that is driving edge to become more intelligent, edge to have more machine learning on that edge device itself, and then finally send maybe the inference from that data point rather than sending everything to the cloud. And then you can also, there's also a talk of, for example, bringing blockchain into IoT. That's, I think it's almost...
Way to get more funding.
More funding, it's another... I think there is we have looked at blockchain from an investment thesis standpoint. I think it's pretty disruptive. It almost takes us back, you know, before the cloud, onset of cloud, it takes us back to distributed computing model. And I think it'll happen as more devices, connected devices come up in the world, because you cannot have clouds all the time. As the trusted authority, you can distribute authority across X number of nodes and have blockchain manage that. So that's how we see IoT, and from an Intel Capital standpoint, we are investing pretty heavily into IoT. Intel acquired a Mobileye from Israel for over $15 billion. That's in the autonomous driving space. That's one of the key focus areas for Intel's IoT group. We also acquired Wind River 8+ years ago, which is an embedded operating system. Anywhere you go, you never see Wind River inside, like Intel or Microsoft or Android, but it's Wind River powering your ATM machine and everything else. So Intel as a company is very serious about how IoT will grow and how particularly machine learning will be driven to the edge, because for Intel, the more compute on more devices, the better it is.
You see, you're saying that the commercial aspects of IoT are probably driving the actual business and actual sort of value in the IoT value chain, for especially for investment purposes. Do you see that value driving improved performance in the consumer space? I mean, in a sense, I actually think IoT in automobiles is kind of a consumer use, right? Because, you know, it's the consumer that's going to end up having to somehow put the, you know, $50 a month to get IoT value into their car kind of bill, or deal with the higher prices of their vehicle because it's been embedded in the cost. Yeah.
I think on the consumer, I gave a home example a lot of startups have tried and nothing has panned out. At best, I've seen insurance as a potential business model here. Insurance companies saying, hey, if you put sensors in your home and I can see a leak before it becomes big, I'll pay you for that. But even that's early. I think to answer your question, what we are seeing is car is maybe the only one that kind of interfaces between consumer and enterprise. But beyond that, most of the IoT innovation is really focused on enterprise side. Now, over time, you can imagine maybe it will trickle down on the consumer side, but we haven't seen that necessity or that compelling use case till now. And there are companies that have, I would say, run out of steam waiting for that model. There's a portfolio company of ours called Arriant. It was acquired recently. It did okay. And it was an IoT company bringing software-connected devices in the home, and it had big hopes. This was 3-4 years ago, but it hasn't panned out. And that's what we are seeing as a trend, not just for that company.
Okay, somebody had posted a video of a water turbine to use, like, you know, ocean currents. And I was like, why is it not everywhere? And somebody commented, because of the maintenance problem. And I was like, why can't we solve it, like, you know, by predicting, or, like, you know, putting a sensor there that the machinery has broken down, and then put it on the network somewhere that it needs maintenance, and, like, you know, maintain that way. Do you see some of that kind of work happening?
Yeah, it's a great question. You know, we all look at IoT as either something that touches us as a consumer, or something that we see in the IT space, in the tech space, I would rather say. But the real IoT is connecting archaic industries, whether it is railroads, whether it is or other archaic industries, almost ancient, you know, so they are ripe for innovation. But if you can bring connectivity and machine learning to those, that's real IoT. There are actually companies we are seeing. One company that we came across called Vitronics, W-I-tronics, Siemens, and we are not investors, we have no relationship with the company, but they are bringing IoT into the railroad space, which I was quite surprised about. And I started asking them, hey, are they really adopting this? You go to them with a solution, do they understand? Do they really adopt? And the company is getting some good traction at least. So we are starting to see those trends, but I think one of the things we always ask ourselves and question even ourselves on is why now? Because a lot of things are possible conceptually, but when we invest, we have to make sure it is now meaning in the next 1 or 2 years, this company can get traction versus 5 years from now. Because otherwise you're just too early in the market and the money will go nowhere.
So just, so most of these, you know, say retail company which have made the biggest transformation, Amazon being one, and you know, Target has invested in Walmart. So the first investment that they did, it was in supply chain, which means trucks, shipping, and containers. So that's how, like, you know, Amazon, if you look at Amazon use cases, that's where they made the biggest kind of changes. How do you deliver something fast, all the way from a shipping deck, which got shipped from one part of the world to another part of the world, enabling, and that is all IoT, right? RFID enablement, then you track it through some kind of camera or some kind of device. And to me, so transportation is something which has already disrupted it. And then logistics, a lot of logistics. Today, like if you want to ship something from Minnesota to here, you don't know, a truck starts and that guy keeps calling you. So logistics is another space which is using it. And again, normal day-to-day life, which consumers like me will be, you know, helped with, but at the same time, enterprises will make a lot of money and completely disruption in that space. So there are shipping and logistics and transportation are something which all these companies, like retail, they make use of that to get their business, you know, forward. And then if you look at those examples, taking example of Amazon, like they built a lot of these clouds and distributed data centers and fulfillment centers and shipping centers. And then they have enabled IoT all across industrial as well as moving. But then one of the points that, the reason that why now, right? Because now software is so tightly integrated, you have so many lighter protocols working on so many lighter devices that it's feasible for you to remotely manage all of that. So I believe that it's right technologies, and then the innovation happening, like, you know, the Moore's Law kind of applying, and better protocols, better software coming in. And these are the areas which have really enabled, like, you know, other than the verticals, like, you know, industrial automation, and then autonomous cars, like billions of IoTs running on a car. So yeah, a lot of retail space has really been disrupted because of shipping and transportation.
Hi, Sanjay, the question I have for you was, at what level do I have to come in at? I mean, it's ironic you mentioned Meraki. I was talking to Meraki before you bought him, and then that was the end of the conversation. Do you have to come in at before Intel Capital starts looking at you? The second question is, are any of you guys doing anything with medical?
With medical?
Yeah, and I mean more than just a Fitbit, which everybody loses.
What was the last sentence you said?
And more than just a Fitbit, something more serious along with patient monitoring or disease outbreak monitoring, which is where I'm focused at. Third question is, given this recent FCC decision, how do you see that affecting networking?
Yeah, so I'll go in order. First question, what stage do we invest into?
What stage do I come at you?
For Intel Capital to fund. So we are, I would say overall, we are stage agnostic, but our sweet spot is around Series A plus. So at a point when you have a few pilots that have moved into production, you have early revenue, you know what market you are going after, you have developed a product, you have found your product market fit, and from there on you want to scale customers and partners, That's when we come in, Series A plus. A typical check size we write is $5 to $10 million. I will mention that increasingly we are writing even bigger check sizes. So the focus really is, how do we make a bigger impact, have more ownership in the company, and hence bring more strategic impact to Intel as well. That's driving that change as well. But I would say Series A plus is still really the focus point. I have done seed deals as well. We do seed investments as well. We funded companies and universities, startups that are university spin-offs, and in those cases we invest like $200K, $300K. But that's not really the top focus for Intel Capital. Second question was on medical side, and our Fitbit, like,
so money. Better, John, you were talking about how IoT is really going to be focused on the enterprise and not the consumer.
IoT in a hospital, right? I mean,
IoT in a patient, that's getting to the patient, that last mile is hard. It's difficult. Costs, pharmaceutical costs, line of dots or something like that. Closing that mile using IoT, working both at the enterprise and consumer, it's the same.
Yeah. So, I invested in a company called Basis Science. I did that investment 2013. Within 8 or 9 months, Intel actually ended up acquiring the company. It was a very good exit financially for Intel Capital. But I'll tell you, honestly speaking, what the company did was, this was pre-iWatch days. It had, I would characterize it as a health watch. It could do your sleep monitoring, it could do sweat analysis, a lot of the data. Their vision was that as the device scales, they'll get so much data, and then they can do a lot more analytics and hopefully sell analytics as a service. That vision never panned out, okay? Despite the successful financial exit, I'll say tell you that vision never panned out, and it was integrated into Intel's wearables group. At that time, Intel was looking at, hey, maybe wearables is really the next big thing, next big computing thing. So I want to have this capability, and that's why Intel acquired the company. But I think wearables as a market has really not panned out. And I used to think that the top use case to drive wearable adoption will be healthcare, will be the kind of things you're talking about. If a doctor wants to make sure that a consumer's, my heart rate is being monitored more continuously rather than once a month when I go to the doctor, hey, you have the data. The problem is, if you look at the healthcare sector, there's huge spending happening. I don't remember the latest number, but $2 to $3 trillion a year. 50% of that comes from government, and most of the remaining comes from corporates, from companies. Consumers actually, despite the fact that we all feel we have to spend a lot on healthcare, we actually don't spend much. And the number one problem in the healthcare system, forget investment, forget technology, all that, in the healthcare system, the number one problem is not technology. The number one problem is care. So when you have a market where, and on top of that, it's a regulated market, keep in mind. HIPAA compliance, you can't take the data, it's not easily accessible. Right? So in that kind of a scenario, when you as a startup or Basis or anybody else comes up with a new tech solution, goes to a hospital, they say, okay, it's interesting, but my budget is tied to providing better care first, then I'll come to your tech solution. And that has been the case. That has been consistently the problem with healthcare. And that's why healthcare, you don't see, when you see startup, when you see SDN startup, they're not going after healthcare as the first market for that reason.
On the healthcare front, I did some work for a couple NGOs overseas, India, Africa areas, and there, the NGOs would love to have wearable devices that they could help, you know, monitoring diabetes and all kinds of other disease-related factors. In that fashion, because otherwise they get, again, a data point a month when they get somebody to come through a clinic, but there they have the problem of funding. Who's going to pay for it? You and I might buy a watch because it helps, you know, helps us keep track of our health. But in most of the world, they don't have the money for that.
So when you're talking about all the investments, that's not just the wearable investment, right? Because some of the use cases that we see, at least now, you know, being in like, you know, Google, and I hear a lot of machine learning and AI doing, is that like how the care could be better, and like going back to NGOs, that, you know, what if we can, you know, create a scanning device which will become a wearable, and then you take it to some countries like where people don't have access to it, right? And then you can use those devices, and then go and scan somebody's, say some report, right? Scanning the report, scanning your, if you have a pacemaker, maybe you don't have access to it, and supporting, you know, elderly people who used to just kind of do just a click of the button kind of thing, instead of consistently monitoring them with the body movement. So those are some areas where I hear, which is not really wearables for the kind of, you know, fancy wearables thing, but really using technologies for providing healthcare in places where it was not accessible, and to the set of people who are, you know, who are, I would say, mobility constrained. So is that an area where you see some growth happening, or even that is kind of constrained?
We do see those things happening, for example, in India and China, where there is no care available. Instead of that, you at least get some care available. But like Rob mentioned, pricing becomes somewhat of a prohibition even there, and that's the challenge. What we have seen is some companies that are coming up with new data, pure non-hardware, pure data-oriented solutions for healthcare, they'll actually first go to Asia to implement, because regulations are more lax there, they can get better adoption there, and they can even get access to that data more easily. So we've seen that trend in several cases. And then they'll try for US, go through HIPAA compliance, et cetera. But it takes time. It's almost like education. We all, you know, love education as a market. We all want kids to get educated and everything. It's such a massive market, but there's very little innovation happening. It's very similar reasons. That it, just like healthcare education is also a highly regulated market. If I create a startup and go to, in the K-12 space, and go to a school and say, hey, I have a better solution to teach chemistry, the school unions and boards will just oppose it right away.
I just wanted to ask, this year just started, and what kind of disruptive changes you expect? It would be interesting, thank you. Trends
in general, or SDN?
Yeah, in trends, maybe, like blockchain, maybe SDN.
You know, the way we look at it, and I'm taking a very broad view here, not an Intel view only, I think we are seeing digitization as a big trend. And as companies learn more about digitization and they adopt digitization, that's when they get more disruptive, self-disruptive rather. And data is a new oil under that. So any company that has lock on data, differentiated data at scale, will have tremendous value. So companies, whenever we look at especially application-oriented companies, we always ask ourselves, how does this company get an unfair advantage in collecting data? Because over time, a lot of the algorithms, whether it's machine learning algorithms or other algorithms, are getting open sourced. So whether you may have access to it today, you may have tuned them better today. 2 years from now, somebody else will. And at that point, your lasting differentiation is the data that you have, because you can leverage that to train your algorithm better than your competitor at that time. And in that big trend of digitization, with data as a new oil, you can put blockchain, you can put AI, you can put other such sub-blocks underneath that are enabling that trend of digitization. 90% of the CEOs, I'm talking of corporates, 90% of the corporate CEOs are probably thinking about digitization, but only 10% are doing something about it. And companies, CEOs who don't act on it will probably be left behind. You know, every 2 weeks, there's one company leaving Fortune 500, S&P 500, every 2 weeks. So it doesn't come out as a big trend, but slowly there's a churn happening in every industry, whether it is transportation, whether it is retail, whether it is industry, etc., etc. And that's a trend we are going to see more of, I feel. And it's an opportunity as well for Intel as a company, for Intel Capital to invest in companies that are enabling that trend, for a lot of companies.
I think the disruptive, well, the potentially destructive technology is the inability to change. I've talked to a number of companies that are trying to figure out how to migrate. You know, it's like they've kind of glommed onto containers, and sort of the simplification that does to their infrastructure is the answer, but they don't know how to get there. And in a sense, they're right. If they can't figure out how to move to this different packaging model, this different, you know, network access model, the different services that are being driven by that sort of more advanced or maybe just more modern automation ecosystem, that's what's going to disrupt. Because even though they might be the leader in their particular market, if they can't keep up with some startup that says, well, I'll plug 8 SaaS services together and tie machine learning in for my cloud provider and do the same thing that you were doing, but now I also have the ability to accelerate my application deployments, right? I can tie into the edge services because I can give you a container that includes my code that does the work that you need at the edge. That's, I think, where I'm starting to see things that are disrupting how people do their business.
Yeah, you know, I looked at your, you know, at one of the posts too, but and digitization, like, you know, everything is becoming e-commerce, and then every single, I believe, like in few years, every single company would be in some kind of cloud because they want some web presence, right? So absolutely. And what it has done, and I'll take example, like say recommendation, right? I like that example, recommendations that you get on your web pages, taking to AdWords and other things. So what has it done? It has brought the power in consumers' hand. Digitization has disrupted because it has given power instead of enterprises. Take example of Uber, take example of a loyalty app. Every single company has loyalty app these days. And then it gives me as a consumer power to decide what I want, right? And then that's where the power of data comes in. So the power that enterprises will be left with, whether Uber, the biggest disruptor. The reason that they could then do that disruption, because of the data, right? You're just picking up data, you're just bringing Waze, right? Look at like Waze getting acquired by, you know, competing with other companies. But it's really the data that you're collecting. So the company that will make good use of that data and really driven by majority of customers, like, you know, billions of customers, is the one that will kind of, it's about velocity, using the data, but that happened because of the digitization. So all those 3 points, automation and disruption because of digitization, making data, you know, the most critical asset for any company.
Google as a search engine.
Yes, absolutely. Search engine, AdWords, see, I brought it in. And then you're right, like machine learning and all those algorithms, that's why I brought in TensorFlow, right? Deep learning, a lot of the work that Google has been doing in that space, you see all of that in open source, Kubernetes, open source, Istio, open source. Because, you know, you believe that you want to collect data and help billions of people, and I can maybe just pitch Google's kind of vision. It's just, you know, organizing the information of billions of people,
yes,
and just helping through the data. So that's what it's really about.
Yeah, like, you know, Google was not the first search engine, right?
Yeah.
But it was the best, so that's why.
Yeah, that's the best.
And one of the one of my favorite examples in networking is of a disruptor technology is WhatsApp. Telecom space. Messaging used to be a major source of revenue until, like, you know, applications like WhatsApp came along.
I saw this graph and I don't remember exactly, but it took like 20 to 30 years for those traditional telephone adoption. And WhatsApp had 450 million users at the time of acquisition, and they had that within like 4 years or so. So the pace of technology adoption has gotten much faster, and it's only going up as time progresses.
Yeah, so on that positive note, I think we can close the panel.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, everyone.